Very nice to see you all. I think some of you may have been here last week. Last week was really the first of a parallel technique meetings, really. The idea of this came about when Sam called the office and said, look, people are going to AA night school, he's actually involved in some way. I think what interested us in discussions in the office, and more like Tate myself, was actually, we talk about architecture, all of us, all the time. In fact, Jim McKinney and I were joking before we came in, if you ask an architect to talk about the city, they show you their latest project. So architecture is kind of first, second, and last that we do. And actually, there is a kind of interesting tension between what you think is an architect in terms of your ambition to make, manage, design space, liaise with clients, make places in cities or in rural locations, and actually the nature of the organisation that you design or you don't design, you design over time, that's very rarely discussed. How you set up the way you might make architecture may have a bigger impact on architecture than any of us are ever might like to believe, or led to believe. Certainly there's a kind of interesting tension between the fact that an architect has all their education in the first 5 to 7 years of their kind of architectural career. So you know nothing, you come to architecture and you're rammed full of education, and then you're thrown out of the world as a supposedly finished object, person, being, practice. And there is a discussion about that, whether actually, if architecture is an engaging subject, then perhaps your engagement with it might be designed by you. So it could be a question about, do you design your education more than we do at the moment? So I think we all like to think we've been in charge of where we go and what we do, and who we study with, which unit you select, which school, or which country, and which office you go to. But in another way, the reality is, you're in a system, you come in, you go to the conveyor belt, you come out the other side, you get qualified, and then you go off and do architecture. So in a sense, that's mirrored that kind of dilemma of studying everything at the beginning and then suddenly practicing forever without going back into study is mirrored by the fact that we only discuss what people make, how they design, what they talk about. We rarely discuss the organisational structures they have set up to allow themselves to do what they do. And I think ultimately, the reality, certainly from our experiences, things like the control of the project finance, the control of the contractual relationship with the person who might build your project with their makers or a main contractor, a lot of that was raised last week. All these things have a huge impact on the architecture you make, which really led us to speculate that what came first, the practice or the architecture. Perhaps the way you design, where your practice might think about architecture might have a much, much bigger impact on the architecture you make, how you make it, and who you make it with. So that's the sort of theme. And it's very much the idea that each speaker will just talk about their experience, their response to the question. There's been no kind of organisational cohesion about sort of tying everyone up. But the idea is different people, different stages of career, different relationships, and different models of practice will come tonight, as previously revealed to you, what has informed what they do. And then I think we should hopefully have a discussion about actually how big an effect has that had on architecture, and is it actually more defining than we might think. So it's Jim McKinnon, Joe Morris, and Jim Eyre.
Simon, thanks very much for that. And only a couple of observations, really thinking about the discussion that took place last week. Two things. Firstly, the AA is a very appropriate place to have this discussion, because when you think about how an architecture school might be organised, clearly the AA is a sort of country house model. But I've often wondered whether the unit system, which was a great radical invention coming out of the AA, didn't owe something to the fact that there was a sort of below stairs atmosphere about the way that this place is actually organised itself. It's not exactly Bureau Landschaft, is it? And did the feeling that you could organise things by units of people in spaces that were quite hidden or discreet in this kind of maze of buildings that's gradually grown in recent years, did that have something to do with the formation of the ideas about how you might teach architecture? And from a personal perspective, just thinking about how architectural journalism of a certain era, in particular the Architectural Review and the Architects Journal, rather mirrored the what we might call the facilities management conditions of the AA, operating as they did in an 18th century townhouse in Queen Anne's Gate, where the hierarchy, incidentally, to quite late on in the history of that organisation, they used to meet for morning prayers every morning right into the 1960s, and it was a bit like a kind of private school where the posh boys of the Architectural Review would meet and decide what they wanted to publish, and the Architects Journal, a sort of slightly grubbier, lower school, which made all the money.
Is it your school?
Yeah. To keep the toffs in the stars which they were accustomed, would sort of get the leftovers from the Architectural Review's table, so they were allowed to publish that. And it, of course, this is a slight exaggeration, but it's not entirely exaggerated. And there was that feeling that the whole nature of architectural publishing coming out of the architectural press, an extraordinary institution, was heavily grounded in the physical space, and therefore the physical, spatial, and psychological relationships between the occupants of that building. And I don't think that's pushing it at all far to say that actually, you know, it's not just by their building, shall you know, these days it's by their facilities management regime, shall you know, the kind of faux non-hierarchy, because everybody's all the same with an equal amount of space, except, have you noticed, the MD always has that extra bit with a line of cupboards that mean that they can't quite be heard or seen by somebody else, and I'm sure this is replicated in many architectural offices. I mean, the spatial implications, the spatial hierarchies, and the spatial politics of any institution are revealed by the way in which people are placed in the space in which they work. So there were just two observations following up from last week's discussion. And I'm very interested to see what emerges from this evening, because we've got another three practices of a very different variety to tell us something about this whole subject of the organisation of their office, the work that's produced there, and what the relationship might be between ownership, office occupation, and workload. So to kick us off, Jimmy Kinney from Tony Friend Architects. Now, Tony Friend Architects have a very particular place in British architectural culture, since I suppose actually their overseas work may be better known than their UK work in many ways. A great variety of architecture, from embassies to the sort of housing that we used to be able to do in Britain almost as a commonplace, which we now apparently find incredibly difficult. The Telefriend's still doing it in Netherlands and other countries. And some very particular buildings in this town and in this country. And a very strong tradition of people coming out of that practice, forming their own offices, and observably very grateful for the start they had in life. Please welcome Jim McKinney.
That's me.
That's Tony.
Okay. When Simon asked me to contribute to this series about practice, I wondered how best to do this, because it's something I'm often asked about, and actually it's very difficult to talk about it in a way that doesn't turn into talking about your building. So there are a few bits of buildings in here. I'm trying to keep it minimal, so it's not that many. But what I'm really going to try and pull out talking today is about our practice, is how we as a practice actually work and structure ourselves, rather than what that results in per se. So last week, for those of you that were here, Praxis talked about aspects of how they design their practice, really, rather than how they design their building. I think it kind of came down to that. So if you like, it was a kind of meta-design discussion, a meta-practice discussion, some way of talking about what we do. And so I'm going to try and build on that in what I talk about today. But first, I thought it'd be worth just giving you the bare bones of the history and the setup of Tony Fretton Architects. The practice was established by Tony in 1982 as a sole practitioner, and I joined Getting On For 20 years ago, believe it or not, just after the Listen Gallery, which is a picture of the building you may know. So, unlike everyone else that's been talking and will be talking today, I'm not a founder of the practice. I didn't found Tony Fretton Architects, Tony Fretton founded it. I joined some time later. So in a way, that's a kind of unique perspective for this context we're talking about here, which is, whilst a director, I'm not a founder. I didn't make practice like Simon and his colleagues did or anyone else here. I kind of came to something and made sense of it in a way, or we made sense of it together and reinvented it into something else, I suppose. So for the majority of this time, not long after me joining the practice, it stayed pretty constant, about 20 members of staff, more or less. And that's been quite a particular decision, really, for several reasons. The main one probably is that 75% of our work is in Northern Europe, so it's outside the UK. The Netherlands, Belgium, Poland, Scandinavia. We still do have work in the UK, but we have this kind of more broad geographical spread, and it is mainly Northern Europe. We don't have any offices apart from London, so we have no offices in any of these other countries. So effectively, we're a kind of export company. I mean, we have lots of VAT numbers in lots of countries, but we don't have any offices there. So it's really just our office in London that does this. And we employ executive architects to localise our work in these places. So whilst our office is pretty stable, there are 20 architects. The reality is most of the time it's, if you take into account the architects we employ in the conferences, between 30 and 40, another, it kind of doubles in size, really. But that brings its own interesting structural questions, because we have to manage effectively a team of people that are always bifurcated. They're always in two places, and then they're never completely under our control, because they have their own cash flows and their own money to make and their own priorities in this relationship. So it's a kind of interesting way of relating to other architects that are working collaboratively with you, but at a distance. the work we do is across, as you probably already know, across lots of different typologies, residential, offices, as Paul said, governmental buildings, but it really came out of the art. So I suppose we're kind of always arts architects, museological architects, and all these other typologies have kind of had some relationship to that. A lot of the houses we do for collectors or for artists, and a lot of the other building typologies always have some relationship back to that core practice. The other thing that's important about the practice is that both Tony and I have always been involved in some degree in education as well as practice. So Tony's been professor in Lausanne, Zurich, Delft and Harvard all of the time that I've been there. So this means he splits his time between wherever he's professor and the office. So he's only ever in the office 2 or 3 days a week on average. And the rest of the time at the moment, for instance, in Zurich, I think, teaching. So. That adds another kind of dynamic to the practice and the way that we work together and the way that the practice is organised. Tony authors the design in the practice. So he's the author and he runs that with the design team. So there's an author student with the design team. And my role is that I manage the office, design the structures in the office, and work together, deal with finances, fees, take a lead in technical reviews, and I'll often be the client-facing person in the office as well. So a lot of the designs that get developed will need to be presented, and that will often be made. suppose my role, the things that I do in the office, they kind of bring into focus the design work, because I'll also have a role of acting as a critic for that process as well. So I'll often critique the schemes as they go through and bring in broader views on those design processes, like what else we're working on in the office, and also more technical considerations. So in a way, there's a kind of fluid relationship, which isn't purely about someone designs it, someone realises it, but more about somebody, I mean, not dissimilar to your practice, I suspect, more somebody takes the lead on designing it, and somebody acts as a encouragement or irritant or whatever needs to be done throughout the process. So that's a kind of broad background of what practice is and how it's organised. Now, there's been some discussion in this forum and also in the press about the nature of practice changing, the internet, building information modelling, augmented reality, all of these issues. I'm not going to talk about any of those, because I think my experience is that the technologies often find themselves adjusting to certain consistent aspects of architectural practice, which we certainly experience, which is about, which broadly boils down to how people interact and collaborate together to make a project. So therefore it seems appropriate that as AA returns to its night school roots, here we are, this is one of the posters for one of the night schools, back in 1847. So it might be worth a slight digression at this stage to look back at the early modern period at some metafiction, some literary practitioners who looked at their own practice and decided what it all meant to a certain extent. Some of you may know this, between 1759 and 1767, Lawrence Stern wrote The Life and Opinions of Tristram Shandy, in which Tristram relates his life story, ostensibly relates his life story. But his desire to tell the story simply is confounded constantly by digressions. So this story deambulates around, goes on while digressions come back again, to such an extent that Tristram wasn't even born until volume 3 of this book. So we have to wait 2 years in an episodic writing process for Tristram to be actually born into the world, which is, in a way, could reflect the way architectural practices are coming to existence today. Last week, I think, Phil was talking about his background, his education, his architectural education, where he came from, all of these factors which actually probably start practice before you actually start to practice. And they're kind of, there's deeper structures here about how practice operates, just what we do in making our work, but actually where we came from, what our background is, I mean, the AJ, the AR, these kind of structural issues and to a certain extent class issues have an effect on how we make practice and why we do it and how we relate to people. Stern always asserted in his book that he wanted to tell this tale from start to finish in the narrative as a straight line. He already states in the book, and this is to quote Lawrence Stern, that this right line, the emblem of moral rectitude, say Cicero, the best line, say the cabbage planters, is the shortest line, says Archimedes, which can be drawn from one point to another. Now, simplistically, in practice, this could also be the ideal as a diagram for the progress through the work stages. This, some of you might be familiar with. This is the plan of work. This is the RBA plan of work. This is the straight line through which we progress in architectural practice. Working logically from one scale to the next, from one process to the next, ticking off the actions that are traditionally attributed to each work stage as we go through the project. So this is how we all work. This is the pattern of work. This is the well-known R3 courses. Management, the book of practice management published by the RBA. But in a way, Stern's straight arrow line through his narrative is comparable to this idealised plan of work. But often in practice there are competing stresses of cost constraints, client desires, value engineering, and a whole raft of issues which add stress to this idea lots of elements supposed to take through a project. So I'm going to have to rely not on the RBA but on some of Stern's drawings to illustrate how this actual process of making buildings and interrelated to each other might, in reality, work. Now, of course, here he's describing the first four volumes of his book, but you could equally well take these as projects with an architect's office and recognise probably your own way through this narrative, the bottom one showing the difficult start to the project, or the top one showing the difficult end to the project, or perhaps some value engineering, planning permissions, design iterations going on their own, going around and coming back to the same place. Now, you might say, as the cabbage plants did, the best way is to go from start to finish as effectively as you can, but I'm going to argue in this that something that's defined how we've worked in our practice is actually trying to embrace the texture of these digressions that you go on whilst on the design process and try and work those back into the structure of how you make your office. This is one of the diagrams that we use, but it's kind of saying the same thing in a different way, really. The large blue square on the left shows a kind of weekly activity of going through design meetings and iterations, working through it, if you like, cyclically along the line. And the large blue square on the right shows how more irregular meetings try and capture all of that somehow, bring it all together so that you can pull everything back into the way it should go. So, in a way, the main point of getting this far, and I'm going to use a few minutes just to kind of sum this up into the work of our practice, is that these digressions that we constantly go on, that we all go on in our design processes, are a form of research, and they're important. And often in the office, these digressions come into a couple of categories. One is, we'll use that next time, and one is, we can use that now. And I think it's important to recognise, or certainly we find it useful to recognise when ideas are useful because you can utilise them in the current project, or actually they're pulling the project away from its core ideal and you need to save them somehow. And this saving, which was touched on last time, is an interesting question. It's kind of, to use a kind of corporate term, is corporate knowledge capture. It's something that architects are often concerned about, but it's actually very important, which is how do you get these teams of people working on different projects to bring their information to some kind of useful state for everyone else. And we do that in three broad ways. One is that we try and adopt a reverse hierarchy in our office with people working on projects, which means that it's possible and encouraged that I can be doing a detailed package for a part two architect who is running a project. And that would be a job that's given to me to do, and I'll do it. And the challenge there is that part two architect has to become prepared giving me instructions because I'm pretty busy. So there's a kind of pressure there which is productive, but it also means that the decisions they make about what to do are focused on managing people in a very direct way. So we often reverse hierarchy on projects so that you get people working where they shouldn't really be working in a normal hierarchy. And that comes through partly the other aspect of working, which is that we always want people in the office to work on more than one project. So even the death, in my view, which I've experienced, is that you get projects take a very long time in architecture, so you can very easily sit on a project for years and years and years and never do anything else as an architect. You get very limited type of experience. So it seems to us that we always like to give people two or three projects to work on at different levels. And one of those projects may be research project that's come out of our digression on another project which we give to them to do at the same time they're working on a design project. And that kind of helps with this capturing of knowledge because people know what everyone else is doing rather than being in their focused zone for their project. And the other things we do, which I don't think are that uncommon, are key stage reviews where we can bring a management group together and decide which of the digressions that are worth taking outside the project and researching more. And also peer reviews where effectively we take quite a active role in people not related to a project ripping apart another project and putting it back together in order to bring firstly their experience in, but secondly to say we did that, why are we still doing it like that, why is it still not working, this needs to have a law, you know, these kind of issues. Because actually in practice where people are very busy, it's very difficult to be constructive and critical at the same time. So now we're going to look at the projects just to sum up and say how some of these digressions have formed themselves. I'll give you a real example. This is Fuglsang Arby team in Denmark, quite a rural location in Denmark, which was run through competition. Traditional form of contract, albeit Danish. And in this project, the Telefone Architects employed the whole team, so we employed everyone who worked on this project, apart from contracting, we employed everyone. So this was kind of complex geographically, contractually, and in terms of being working in a new culture. But actually, one of the big digressions this project took, which was a kind of contextual one, which was that we kind of, coming from the UK, you kind of get used to people making concrete buildings and putting shuttering up, and huge amounts of time spent on it, and labour spent on it, cheap labour, usually. We went to Denmark, where it's very good, it's proper social democracy, really, Denmark, so there's very high social costs. So what they don't want is lots of people on site. And I think the whole of this project was six people on site at any one time. And that was achieved by then making prefabricated concrete elements, bringing them to site and lifting them into place, because they could obviously make them in a factory under controlled conditions, much less labour, bring them on site, four people could erect them, the whole superstructure went up in, I think, 3 weeks of this building. So I say this really because there's an interesting relationship between social constructs and construction culture. And I, as an architect, you embrace that and you find out about it. It's a digression, if you like, but a useful one. Or you reject it and you build a building how you're going to build it anyway. The other project is the MC of Formation in Warsaw, in Poland, which is another competition win, probably the last grand project by the FCO before austerity really kicked in. And this is under management contracting, so it's a completely different form of contract where we're actually employed by the contractor for this project. And what's to say here is that this line that I described earlier, that you pass through a project, it can often be drawn by lots of competing functions. In this case, you know, we had a bomb in Istanbul, a bomb in Madrid, 2003-2004. That completely changed the spec and the security of this facade. We also had a devaluing pound against the zloty. 2006-2007, so that effectively reduced our budget by a third in real terms of what we could spend. So we had these competing aspects, and what we had to try and do was to focus on what was the important aspect of the project and make sure that idea persisted. And in this case, it was the facade, trying to somehow have an idea that you could represent openness and approachability, but also have a facade that could withstand someone parking a ton of TNT outside the building, blowing up at the same time. So, in a way, one of the digressions we took was to look at the whole building afresh and see where we could actually reduce a lot of things whilst maintaining one aspect which was important to the idea of the building. So, in this progression, I think it's important also that the structure of the office supports the idea of persisting all the way through rather than going off the tangents and being lost and having all these various factors. And this is it, this is the last slide, but it's really just to say that probably the most important thing that's happened to us through our foreign experience is that we've paradoxically, in order to allow ourselves to explore and research some of these ideas in practice, we've become a lot more structured. So we've got hardcore structures and procedures in our office for how we deal with each other, how we have meetings, completely in a way unlike Studio Weave, which you heard from last week, because it's the only way we found we can free enough time to actually do other kinds of research in the office. So sometimes I think having these overriding structures can actually be a huge benefit to freeing you up to do what you want to do. That's it.
Jim, thank you very much for that. A couple of quick questions. Well, first observation. I forgot all about that devaluation of pound against the Scottish. It's a useful reminder about how European economics changes rapidly. Can I ask, was there a moment when you mentioned at the end the kind of more, perhaps more formal structures that are required when you're working in different countries and the same sort of different scale projects to free up that time for thinking and research and have more formality in the office? What sort of stage did that arise out of one particular project, or was it something that just emerged over a period?
It grew really, and I think the thing that slowly dawned on us was, and this is a very direct thing, was when you're dealing with foreign cultures and foreign architects and foreign clients, of course, you can lose a lot in translation. So you have to be very, very straightforward with what you're saying. And that straightforwardness, after a while, we thought, this is what we're doing. Just say it really clearly. And if we can communicate to our fellow collaborators such as him, why can't we do that to ourselves? So we started to formalise that back into our own relationships with each other. Because actually, we found with people that aren't in your office, you'll be much more thoughtful, mindful about how you relate to them. You'll give them the information they need. You'll ask very specific questions. We'll try and get rid of ambiguity. But we never did that in our office. It was full of ambiguity and possibilities. And actually, that was a gradual process. But it was actually the foreign work that made us reflect on how we talk to each other.
And the other one, just a quick one, so I'm sure we'll come back to this later, but the kind of authorial nature of your office with, you know, the founding principal who's teaching, who is there, majority of the time, but a significant minority isn't. How does this work in practice? I mean, do you set that up with a series of meetings when Tony Franklin is in the office working on specific projects, or is it more free-flowing depending on what the project is and what stage it's at?
Well, I suppose there's a formality to it in terms of every week there'll be design team meetings, which Tony will be part of, which are about talking about the progress of the design. But of course, technology does help a lot with that, because drawings are going back to forwards and iPads and all the rest of it, and Skype and all this can help. But it is quite formalised in a way, because you find that people prepare for it and therefore they focus on what they want to talk about. But a lot of the way we make that happen is that a whole host of decisions won't even go to Tony Coleman. Yeah. So there is a separation in that respect. I'll just say, we're not even going to talk about this. Next week we're not going to talk about this, we're going to talk about this, because you get to know how it's, you know, how it's going.
That's great, Jim. Thank you very much. We're going to move on to Joe Morris, Doug Morris, graduates of the Altman Hall, Morris, Part 4, if I could put it like that, School of Architecture. Doug Morris, a kind of, what can we say, Manta Medal winners, have established a reputation in a very short period of time for doing very thoughtful, very hard class, edgy, ideas driven. Over to you.
First line, typo. Third word in, old rather than old, just a little bit in there. So I'd like to stand while I do this presentation. I think one of the things which comes out of the sort of thinking practice is, comes back to what we talked about last week, which is the sort of the name and the idea of the culture. So hopefully you can sort of see, I think there are three screens. I'm going to point at this larger one because it's easier for the pointer to do. But in effect, we're going to collaborate. So Jim, you're going to do this sort of change of the slides and I'm going to talk about it. So a little bit unlike what Jim's talked about, I'm going to major quite a bit on the work, because I think it's the work that's really important to us as a sort of an embodiment of the cultural position of the practice. So if you go to the first slide, I'm going to talk to you about sort of geographic, demographic, cultural, political kind of backdrops, and then really kind of major on a kind of past and future in terms of the kind of the outputs of work of the office. If you go to the third slide, not poor on this one, but effectively we are a British Isles-based practice. Next slide. We are a London-based practice, next slide, and we are a Shoreditch-based practice. We've, personally, I've sort of worked with Ian Parkinmar since 90, I think 95, 96, when I first joined Paul and Simon at the HMM, and they were my tutors as well. So in a way, the kind of the DNA and culture of Shoreditch has been a sort of bedrock to everything that we sort of stood for from that time on. And if I think about, if I try and capture what I think Shoreditch is, it's this idea of a sort of multicultural, multi-ethnic, multi-reference, multi-kind of political kind of backdrop with grit, grain, brick, Georgian, Victorian warehouse, all sort of colliding together. As you all know, Old Street is now the epicentre of everything which is the future, and it's about sort of bringing TNT, which is the telecommunications, media, and other sort of, you know, small, medium, emerging employers. It's about innovation, and it's about, I suppose, kind of design excellence in many respects. And I kind of think that as a practice, sort of located up here in the Nile Street studios, that we embody that sort of thinking, that ethos. We are very much a sort of 20-man band. We are thinking about the methodology of practice beyond the standard, which is a top-down approach. We are about the collective, we are about the collaborative, and I think that's what I'm trying to express to you this evening through this presentation. Next. Demographically, our origins are. Next. If I sort of say to you that in this cluster at the bottom near the sort of London-based condition, and the idea that we're a London-based practice, and the fact that our kind of founding members are effectively Londonites, although I'm from Leicester. What's interesting to me is this idea that sort of nationally, the culture of the office is spread far and wide. We have people, employees from Glasgow and Stirling. We have people from, Milton Keynes, Oxford, Ashford, West Bromwich, and Birmingham. Next slide. But wider afield, I think over time, the initial sort of coming together, the genesis of the practice, is very much about a reputation built on those people that you know. So if, for example, you study at Barnes School of Architecture or you're working out of London, your network of friends or your network of contemporaries are very much local. Over the last initial 4 or 5 years of practice, we eventually got into a situation where culturally we were able to sort of communicate what we were doing to a much wider sort of global network, global community, through competitions that we were winning, through the kind of general sort of social network and being able to kind of download and upload information onto that. And so what's happening now is that we have people from Mexico, from Germany, Madrid and Sydney being part of this much wider kind of cultural reference for the practice, which at its core is a Bartlett-driven, process-driven, London-based condition. But bringing all these kind of wider cultural references creates a much richer output of work, which is less, I suppose, hung up on these kind of initial origins. Next. Practice-based. The first top two bars are myself and Mary. So we set up in 2004. We've been going to the end of this year for about 9 years. We're just about to have the classic 9th year anniversary. We are London-based, let's say we're Bartlett-based. And in effect, this is the kind of the composition of the practice that currently stands, which is about 19 or 20 people. There's 17 or so architects, so we've got kind of admin support staff, which sit outside of that, full-time members. There has obviously been a massive interchange and a kind of bringing in and letting go of people. Again, Simon, I worked for Simon and Paul at HMM, as did many other of my contemporaries, who over a period of time had the robustness in their kind of training, the opportunities and network to kind of then spin off and create their own destiny, which is what I've done. So up at this sort of front end between 2005 and 2009, there were a lot of people that kind of went in and out, and actually you can see here, the back end, this is all still with us. So there's a sort of hole there of Bartlettonians that went in and out, but in effect, the core of the practice is Bartlett-based. And it's only up until about sort of 2009 when things started to change, when this sort of global opportunity, the opportunity to kind of bring a wider network of cultural references started to have an impact on the practice. So if I think about what we were producing as an early practice, so the likes of the Mersey Observatory, Bexhill, Shelters, a couple of other competitions, I think some of them were awarded at Nippon Futures. They had a repetitive, sculptural, light, loose, idea about their art, and edgy about their work, and I think gradually as time has moved on, the work output and the type of work and the type of materials and the contextual considerations have developed and matured. And I think that's very much down to both experience but also the range of other references. So you can see there it goes from Bartlett to London Met, Mendruso, Exxon in Madrid, right the way down to kind of Macintosh in Edinburgh. So currently, we have a kind of very diverse practice base. If you think about a group of about 15 or 20 people, the top four or five are in Bartlett, the top four or five are in London, the rest is international. Next. So as a composition, we're two directors, there's one associate stroke associate director. We have four senior architects in the context of the discussion about protection of title. We also have four international architects who can't call themselves architects because of the way the ARB works, so they're effectively assistants, but they bring a whole range of experience, which sort of makes up about 50% of the composition of our practice. And then we have seven assistants, all of which are part two plus 1 year and above. So what we found to be a better, more productive methodology for work is that we have people with some experience rather than people with no experience. We found that no experience is a really hard thing to manage, even though you're paying them very little, because effectively you're coming out, I think, Simon, I think you remember telling me very often, and I think I can say this in public, because you're all adults, Joe, you know, fuck all. That's the sort of thing that we've sort of come to the conclusion over time, but actually, you do know something, and it really helps in terms of developing ideas and being efficient. As in terms of the kind of the geographical and sort of textual quality of our practice, we've moved on three or four times in our lifetime through basements, through 500 square feet, to now an office which feels palatial, which could probably take a capacity of about 40 people. Well, we don't have any real ambition to be there, but it's kind of a low rent, back of Shoreditch. Apparently you can't get there, but I get there every morning. We have an upstairs with a meeting room, a desk, we have breakout space. We have a shop front, which again communicates, it's almost like a live website, the work that we do back onto the streets. And we also have access, which is the classic Derwent sort of package, which is a sort of basement with some kind of street connectivity, which is a clear story window. Also, we're interested in sort of displaying all of the kind of content of our work, so models and drawings and visuals and clutter and samples proliferate throughout the office. Again, I do think that's a really important sort of pattern of the work, enforcing the ethos of every single person through the practice. Next. I was sort of thinking about the sort of structure of practice, sort of the classic pyramid of sort of founders or directors at the top, and then you've got your mid-tier and your bottom tier. The way that our practice works, a little bit like what you were saying, Jim, is that effectively we're all at the bottom. So the directors, the senior architects, the collaborators, the admin staff, the cleaners are all effectively part of this cultural ambition of the output of the practice. If the middle layer is the filter, and we filter through dialogue and discourse and exchange and presentation, every single person has an opportunity to bring something to the table, and those ideas are kind of put through this sort of process machine. The top of the kind of pyramid is effectively the idea, the object, the objective, and I think that's something which is really, really crucial for us. If you go to the next slide, we've got a much simpler diagram about how we work, Jim. Ideas come in from the left through context, attitude, brief, and sight, which sort of starts the genesis of an idea that's then tested against some basic principles, whether they be kind of practice ambition, past experience, or whatnot. That's then goes through a cyclical process and outcomes of proposal. The proposal could be kind of stage-related or project-based, and the whole thing can be run as a further cycle. But it's quite a simple experimental, explorative, and research-based method that we adopt. Next. Collaboration I'm going to talk a lot about. We love to collaborate, we love to share ideas. The collaboration is not just about working with other architects, but it's about working with other consultants, community members, but also the idea of the client. One of the kind of adages that we use is the idea that if you're all wearing your jacket, your laboratory jacket with your architect, your structural engineer, your service engineer tag on it, before you walk in the room, you take those jackets off, you leave them on the outside, you step through the threshold, and everybody's working through a sort of a creative exchange. So, in effect, I might start talking about figures of costs, the engineer might start talking about programming the sequence, the service engineer might start talking about the kind of qualities of materials. I think that's, again, quite an important thing. Rather than talking about the kind of silo effect of a kind of series of people exchanging on a very limited territory, all those get thrown into the mix, and as I'm working together, you shape that up, which I think is quite important. And we do that also with our work with other practices, of which Orford Hall is one of them, where it's an opportunity to try and work out an organic methodology, seeing where the territory lies, who is responsible, who has ownership, which bit of the things are you looking at, and what are you tweaking. We use immersion as a methodology, as something which has developed over time, and it's a thing which I think we're actually very good at now. The principal idea of immersion is to effectively, in the same way that you remove your lab coat, you remove preconceptions and language, and so every single project, every single client is trying to basically share a dictionary of terminology around which you can discuss a project. So it's trying to unravel the kind of archibabble, but it's also unraveling the things which a client might bring to the table, which are, again, sort of preconditions and pre-stereotypes. And in the same way we do that, the next slide, we do the same with kind of cultural exchange and embracing of the office to see other architects' work. So we've got Herzog, we've got Smithsons, and various sort of generic sort of Swiss architecture examples. That it's a sort of collaborative, it's about doing it as a kind of collective rather than individually. We all have something to say, but I think in lying and talking about those things and exploring those things together has always paid dividends. Next. We like to exchange locally. So this is like, as in sort of the Red Shirt Street. That's our office drinking. And next slide, we also like to exchange globally. This is the same office out in Copenhagen looking at one of the sort of master plan schemes sort of painting the town red. Next. Our plan of work, next. I guess, whatever you call it, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, A, B, C, red triangle, whatever. Effectively, we find that in the procurement methods that are applied to many of development schemes, for example, certainly within education and various other sort of specialists, and you compare that to residential, is that the procurement methodology composites you in certain spaces. So, for example, if it's design and build, you might have full remit up to about a D. Beyond that, you're in conversation with a contractor. If it's traditional, it's about bespoke homing. You run the whole thing right the way through in your relationship with the clients. Some architects, we think, specialise in to D. Some architects specialise into E onwards. We did a lot, and I think that's really important. We have an ambition to build, to craft, to be engaged on site with every project that we do. It's not always possible, and certainly in master planning and in sort of collaborative on the kind of the idea of city fragments, we don't get an opportunity to do that, but clearly we are interested in doing so. For example, A to B, I'm going to go through this really quick, Jim. A to B, we've got some sketch, stage seats, exploring models as a methodology to define the kind of key ambitions for the project. Stage D, next slide. It's about using kind of more technical and sophisticated methods to describe space, texture, light. Next slide. It's then about kind of unraveling and introducing modern methods of construction, repetition, simplicity, efficiency. Next slide. It's about, go through these quite quickly. This is about, every second, just hit the button. This is about being able to understand sequencing, the construction, simplicity, repeat methods, modular construction off-site to create something which is unique, which is a project we've got down in South London. This is a project in its sort of frame space, so having an opportunity and a resolute ambition to build and see things on-site, to understand the lines that you draw on paper, mean something on-site, and it's about quality of execution, being and monitoring that, feeding that back into practice, and next, the aftercare, the opportunity to talk about that with the rest of your staff as well, to again, to embed the ambition and ethos of thinking into practice. Next slide. Networks are really important. Maybe every 10 seconds, Jim, just press the button. So we're working on a number of projects. This is Hayes, Middlesex, it's the old vinyl factory. Sewery, Great West are the leaders. Orford Hall, Doug and Morris are sort of touching the corners. Great Eastern Quay is a big master plan project on the outskirts of London near City Airport. MacLab doing the scheme, Winifred Watson and Doug and Morris pushing a couple of buttons in the corner and testing, plot testing. Brentford Block West is a true, stall on this one for a moment, Jim. This is a true collaborative submission for a bid against 18 other practices. We have no specialism or background in residential development, certainly never have master planned by ourselves before. We're a young practice, I say, of about 20 over about 7-8 years. We decided on this particular one to join forces with Caracus, which Carson, who are probably one of the growing, emerging specialist kind of housing developing sort of practices. Richie's already McHale, we do light touch environmental and ourselves to do edgy, and we thought you should collect those things together, that would make quite an interesting team for ISIS and Brentford. We won the gig, it's now on site, next slide, sorry. Working with Orford Hall, kind of supremo master plan, historical, one of the most important sites, I suppose, in London. And we were asked to develop and test a particular site, which McMillan Lab to be doing on the other side of the site. Again, this is about coming up with something which could be developed in a very bespoke manner to something which is quite generic. We like bespoke, and that's what we're advocating on these slides. Next. This particular one, again, we won in bid. It's ourselves and made the submission. We won lot two, which for those of you can see the big screen, is the kind of the long linear slab in the middle of the picture to the left. It's the kind of news houses at the bottom of the image, and then kind of centre right is that kind of configuration of units. Avanti won lot one, which is effectively the overbuilds and underbuilds for all this kind of site in Camden. We thought actually what would be quite good is to bring the two lots together, develop it as a cohesive redensification of an existing urban plot collaboratively, and I think it's currently for planning consent is due in June. Next slide. And then this is a current one we're working on. It's an open bid, so again, I don't know whether any of you know any others are bidding for this, but it's the likes of Zaha, OMA, Addison Brooks, Mechanin. I don't think we have a helling chance, but we thought, how do we make it to our advantage? Let's invite David Chipperfield. We work with Robin Lee, who again is young, kind of emerging young supreme architect, and try and develop something which is about the team rather than the scheme itself as a way of kind of leveraging this 2 million square foot redevelopment site in Greenwich Peninsula. Next. In terms of DNA, very quickly, next slide, Jim. Just a couple of things which are kind of constantly kind of in the background for our work. So we're interested in the ephemeral, the delicate, the light, things which sort of have been floated in, perhaps slightly alien. This is in stark contrast to the next slide, which is the idea of something which has grown out of the ground, so it's kind of heavy brick, mass density, longevity, robustness, something which has a time, a sort of immortal presence, I suppose, in contrast to the delicate. The next slide. We're interested constantly about discussing about the kind of detail of windows and how they start to reflect on kind of compositional structural logic of a building, whether it's something which is flush, protruding, or set back, or not at all. We're really interested in the notion of the kind of core essence of a building. If you strip everything away, in the same way that a ruin speaks very much about a structural logic of a building, some sort of narrative and some history and poetry. We use brass as a methodology to highlight certain aspects of schemes, sort of preciousness, but quite cost efficient, next slide. And obviously context is very important. Okay, so I'm going to fly through the next 10 slides. So this is our past. This is probably what we're known for having done. So as Paul says, we won the Manston Medal, the Stephen Lawrence Medal, we won 5 RDA awards, probably the 5 key completed projects. So this is a construction management project, 2009, NEC contract, about £2.5 million, won an RDA award amongst all sorts of other things, sheltered housing scheme. This won the Manston Medal, it's a renovation, a kind of reinvention and a reclamation of a brutalist 1960s architect self-built building in Highgate for an architect couple, unnamed. This one, the Manston Medal, so kind of a couple of other things. Next. We've worked with Derwent, Crown Estates, Stanhope, those sorts of large developers. But again, scraping the surface at the moment, trying to get kind of into the sort of larger projects. So the first completed project we've done for these developers, got an RDA award, it's effectively a shell and core with some light fittings, but again, the light fittings are quite good. Next. Our house, Stephen Lawrence Award, New Sander Road Award nomination, and RDA awards from last year. It's a brick box, and nothing else really to talk about it, but it's about the execution of the detail, which is really important to us. Next. Alberta's is for kind of large cathedral group CEO, he's a really interesting man. He pushed us through the kind of collaborative exchange with himself to really find a very unique response to science. This is about reenacting a kind of agricultural language in a very contemporary means. It's single material against strip back palette. Next. And in terms of futures, last 5 slides. So construction management, £5 million, 1,500 square metres, a specialist mental health learning centre in Denmark Hill completed in summer. Next. a floating cinema that we had on a scale of £100,000, very little money to spend, almost impossible project, I think. Of course, that studio we did last year's one. This is like, it's pro bono all the way. It's for the love of the project, but actually it's kind of bringing us to our knees, completed in July next. Work for Derwent is ongoing, so again, a number of these projects, it's about finding an essence, a kind of truth about building next. Some of you might know this one, Shoreditch High Street. It's kind of an insertion of the very delicate and something which is very heavy. And we kind of like the building just to stop where it is, because we quite like this jagged tooth, sort of ruinous first floor condition. Somehow it's kind of imaginatively and possibly suspended next. Working through the likes of the bar, small project, but again, it's about kind of working with these extreme developers next. Stanhope, the low carbon workplace, 5 million completed this year next. A specialist spoke special needs school up in Buckinghamshire, it's a swimming pool, 16 metres long, unusual next. And I think this is the last one. This is an adult learning centre in Richmond, £7 million total project cost, multiple phases, really complex. It's a sale of one site, Twickenham, taking, I think, 30,000 square foot space and putting it into a site which can't be developed. So it's about stripping out and being really, really clever. Next. Done. Thank you.
Joe, thank you. We're going to move on to Jim Eyre now, but there's a question for you for later, which is actually, supposing you only had a third of the space you've got in your office, what the implication of that be? In other words, that bottle making, that kind of generosity space, how has that affected your work? And actually, Jim, another one for you is actually because you didn't have to mention this, but you might tell us how the spatial organisation of Tendrils Architects works and whether that's a contributory factor to your working method. But the final speaker this evening, Jim Eyre from Wilkinson Eyre, double Sterling Prize winners. Their most recent building, which Ross Lovegrove said to me on the steps of the AA this evening as we were arriving, it was an underrated building, which is their office tower in Guangzhou, which won the RIPA Beckham Prize, but probably isn't actually not that well known, actually. And I think the companies are likely to build a replica of it next door without paying any additional fee, which is a tribute of sorts. So actually, in recent years, I think one of our most successful practices and working at scale, winners of the World Architecture Festival, completed building of the year, Gardens by the Bay project in Singapore. So working international, working across a variety of building types, but I think working at scale. Jim.
Thanks, Paul. Well, actually, it's been as interesting for me watching these two presentations as anything else, and learning quite a lot about what other architects do. And it might surprise you to find out that actually we know very little about what other architects do. We compete against other architects. We very occasionally might find ourselves on a jury of choice, as maybe you do yourself. So just seeing other architects present is quite revealing. And a lot of what we've just seen, I think we could say, is the same in our practice but scaled up. But I think there are crucial differences. And I think it's a lot of that is to do with the size that we are, but in a way actually we're much less reflective about what we're doing ourselves and our structure, our methods, etc. They just kind of work the way they work. That might be something to do with the constant pressure of the work and the number of projects that are in the office, just trying to keep up with it. I think you can see straight away we're probably more corporate than the others. But I'm going to just talk a little bit about the history of the practice. In fact, Jim, actually, I'm not a family member of the practice either. It was started in 1982. Chris Wilkinson started in 82. He had worked at, I think, Lansdowne's, with Eva Yurifnyak-Litsky, Foster's, and Richard Rogers. I think he'd been working on the Lloyds building. He'd also went, I think, after Foster's actually worked. He was the first person to join Michael Hopkins when Michael Hopkins split out of Foster's. And I met him at Michael Hopkins. I did my year out student there, also in 1980, actually, it was. And by about 83, Michael had asked Chris to come in and help me on the project, which actually was the biggest project Michael had ever had at that point in time. It was for Willis Faber in Ipswich. It was a service centre, and it was quite an interesting project, but it was by far his biggest project, and I was really just a year out student. Given this biggest project, which I thought, hang on, I don't know fuck all, actually. And I needed some help.
I learned
very quickly, actually, from that. So I spent 5 years at Hopkins, having done 3 years at Liverpool University, which is, a very good architecture school, very thorough, and the school is very interested in how things work, that everything must work. You know, you've got to demonstrate that everything works. And then 2 years here at the AA, where actually you don't have to demonstrate everything works. So that was a complete change, and actually very broadened my education, but broadened my way of thinking about architecture. So when I joined Chris, I think it was 1986 I joined, and it was just him, the secretary, and Matthew Priestman, who's been very successful architect in his own right. And I think Chris did have a mission. I think he clearly wanted to start a practice that, in a way, reflected the kind of practices he had worked in. And I guess I did as well, you know, when I joined him. We really wanted to do the sorts of projects that we had been doing with these other practices. But because we were small, we spent quite a lot of time doing the usual house extensions. Flats, you know, converting Victorian terraced houses into 3 or 4 apartments. And there was a diet of that, but there was always something interesting going on. And one of the early projects was a Pilates studio, and that was quite fun. And another was installing Renzo Cano's Travelling Technology exhibition at the outside the Natural History Museum and outside the Museum of York, and that was actually extremely interesting. An insight into his work and the kind of technical side of it as much as anything else. And we just kind of grew the practice gradually. We tried to avoid having debt. I mean, we had debt to start with, and as soon as we could get rid of it, we did. We have some now, but it's not all that much. And I think that's always been something that helps one sleep at night, actually. You can try and avoid large amounts of debt, because debt's even more difficult now with the banks, because they're all over you. And you feel that you have to answer them all the time. So if you don't have to do that, you're in a strong position. So one of the first projects was a sort of a biggish break for us, was this building at 10 Trinity Square, which was Willis Faber's headquarters at the time, but it no longer is. And it had been refurbished by Hopkins, actually, just before I got to Hopkins. And then it came back to us, actually, and we refurbished it a second time. So that would have been in the late 1980s. And I was interested to see the tree structure earlier. This was a structure. This drawing on the left was by Clinton Terry, and actually was on the front cover of AR. I can't remember exactly which year. But that, publicity actually is terribly important. It's like sort of oxygen for practices, and we can't deny it. It's actually vital, I think, for gaining attention and gaining work. So even just being on the front cover of AR, and Paul talked about what AR was like in those days, was quite important to us. Actually, this project, which was a central atrium of our hospital, was never built. I just want to talk very quickly about sort of, I suppose they're not really inspirations so much as things we're interested in. So it's sort of lightness, engineering, responsive structures, heaviness to a certain extent, natural materials, geometry, working with steel, even tiny little things like sort of that egg thing that was done last year, we did one. And our method of working is, I think it's probably pretty similar to others in a way, but it has changed since when I first started in the 80s. In the 80s, you have to remember that everyone sat at drawing boards, so you could, your masters could come and look over your shoulder and see exactly what you're doing. Now, you can't do that anymore. With computers, it just doesn't work like that. So we actually had to make an enormous adjustment to the way that we worked to cope with the introduction of computer drawing, which I found traumatic, actually, at the time. It was incredibly difficult to do. But now, I think we must reflect a fairly normal model, I think, of having lots of computer workstations and lots of big tables in the office where you can pull the information out, you print it out, you have models, and you sit around in groups, whoever's leading the project, with the team, and discuss whatever aspect of the project that you're at the time. So we work a lot with models, with computer drawings, computer renderings, and so on. And our model shop is one of the best things we have. It's a big model shop with four model makers. So we're continuously making models which are really the same standard as that you would get outside if you were going professionally made. They are professional model makers. And we use those to develop designs as well as to do presentation models, either for pictures or even just during the currency of any particular project. In terms of the structure of the office, I was interested again for Joe's diagram, because I think the answer is pretty much, it's really the same in a way, and it's the same, it's just bigger because we're about 120 now, and we've got eight directors, we've got a number of associate directors and associates. Now, one of the pressures that comes on with time and growth, of course, is that the people that have been with you a long time want to know what the tail end of their career is going to be like. They stay with you. So the whole this year's succession in a, should we say, mature practice becomes really important. And I think these days people are much more open about discussing it than they used to be. So these tiers of promotion are quite important in terms of people realizing that they've got a career path. At the same time, one doesn't want people that are moving up through the levels to become sort of remote from the architectural process itself. We still want people who are relatively senior to continue to draw on computers where necessary, or sketch or develop designs. So they do generally do that. And across the bottom here, you can see there's various sectors that we work in. One of the other things that I think we've always believed in and always consciously pursued, or the few things that we do consciously pursue, is to be never be a specialist in one thing only, because the market does this. You could just die, and this has happened to a number of practices where if you're only doing residential, and suddenly the market doesn't want residential, you're stuck. So we consciously try to become sort of to develop multiple specialisms, and we found that if you can get those projects to start with, then suddenly you become a specialist. You only really need to do one or two and you become a specialist. It's remarkable, really, but that is how it happens. And then in terms of support, one of the benefits of being larger is that you can build these dedicated teams that look after things. So, you know, finance and administration is important. There's three people in that team. Media and marketing. The media team is not just handling press, it's also generating reports. So architects will feed information to a media team. And that team, the Avery doc, quite often will be produced by graphic designers. They're not doing the design, they're only designing the document and producing it. We in that media team is somebody who's very good at writing, because we have to spend a lot of time making submitting expressions of interest to get work. So we hear about a project, we produce a document, and it's become a very laborious process in itself. Simon, I'll show you all of this. So the huge amount of work has to be done just to get on the shortlist. So you have to get quite good at that. And you need to have everything in place, the various sort of health and safety and various camp protocols and things like that. I can't even remember what they're like, but there's a lot of them. Which has made it quite cumbersome in a way, actually, to practice in a way that I think it was easier in the past. graphics model making and 3D visualization already mentioned. So this is this diagram, which is probably quite difficult to read. This is a sort of typical diagram. I mean, they're not actually difficult because they never seem to be the same. We reinvent them every single time we apply for a job. Identifying individuals for a particular pitch for a job. So the sort of core hierarchy is here. There'll be the director there, project leader, and then the key architects underneath them. And then, of course, there would be a larger team below that. And we have, you know, a head of sustainability will be often on site. You have to have these sustainability reviews. We're particularly interested in that anyway in the architecture. And then Chris on this particular one, or it could be me, will be often on site on that structure quite often. It depends on the size of the project. If it's a bigger project or something that we're very personally extremely interested in, you might be the director in charge. But in principle, Chris and I kind of split the projects between us, and they kind of split themselves in the sense that we, one or other of us would have pursued it, one or other of us might have had the contact come to us. So it's not kind of premeditated in the sense that a project comes in and we sort of sit back and you do that one, I'll do that one. And perhaps now, actually, I should just mention that because we've grown, we have eight directors, and most of those directors have been with us for 20 years or so. We have put a sort of succession plan in place that those directors have acquired equity, and they want to naturally be more autonomous. So they're leading projects themselves, and in many instances, Chris and I have a much lighter touch on certain projects. But I think they've been there long enough to reflect the output of the practice and the values of the practice, so they're still recognisably Wilkinson Air buildings, even though I'd say that our buildings, our architecture is actually quite diverse. It changes from project to project. Going back again in time, Chris always had this big interest in long span, large volume buildings, and he wrote a book about it, which I think you can acquire on Amazon second hand now. Its value might even have gone up, and it's been translated into other languages. I know there's a Japanese version. And I think at the beginning of our practice, we wanted to do these sorts of buildings. We always had that sort of slightly boy's own interest in these big span buildings. And luckily for us, our big break really was on the Jubilee line. There was an architect called Roman Paoletti who was in a position of power on the Jubilee line amongst a sea of engineers who were basically calling the shots, and I don't think they'll ever let this happen again, putting an architect in so much power. He identified a list of architects and identified a list of engineers and told them to sort of get on with it and find each other and bid for the project. We were relatively unknown, so I think we were the sort of last one to be picked, with the last engineer to the, you know, so the last two to be coupled together. We didn't know our engineer at all, ASA, as they were then called. But we won it. It was a design competition, and I think probably a fee bid as well, was material. We won it, and we did this building called Stratford Market Depot, which you can see just south of Stratford Station, between Stratford and sort of going down towards West Ham. And I think also, luckily for us, the construction market was in a really sorry state at the time. So we got a much higher specification building for the budget than we would expect to normally. And that kind of put us on the map. And I remember it was in the Sunday Times as being the major terminus of the Jubilee. Just sort of kept quiet about that. It was just a decade, actually, where they served the train. And a couple of years later, we then, with the same team, won a competition for the station at Stratford. And this architecture was a very interesting thing to do, and it was very complicated because there's all these different levels and lines all over the place. And we wanted a very simple statement. And after the sort of, in a way that all the sort of trusses and things that were at Stratford, I was very dead keen that it had this very plain soffit. And it was designed like almost like a giant blanket. Very and actually there's a row of lights here that reflect up onto the soffit. The soffit is acoustically absorbent, reflects the light back down again, and then the whole of that roof is designed as part of a ventilation system which generates air movement across the space. And you see it in this particular guy's dressed up to try and win the Olympics, which of course we did when they were announced in Singapore. So this was the sort of centre, this was all there was actually extracted to go and look at. And the site was just a part of Earth, really. I mean, maintained an involvement in railway projects ever since. So we're working on Crossrail, dare I say, at HS2. Other projects, Dyson has been something that's been quite important to us. And I think he was summing up a remarkable story, really, of designing a building that was a mere 20,000 square foot that might go to 60,000 square foot, that became 70 and then 360,000 square foot, all in 3 years with one contractor. So that relationship with the client's always been really important for us. That you cannot, if you win a client, you want to hold on to them generally. So you need to be quite good to them and work very closely to them, and they'll keep coming back. So it's staying in that kind of big shed vein. There's a building on the Westway, you might see it, which is an Audi showroom, which has got hundreds of, it's got some quite nice Audis actually. In the top, there's a sort of collection of ancient Audis too. To another sort of vein that we got into by accident, which is, I'll show you this because it's sort of, this is a real case of how you suddenly become a specialist. We did 5 competitions for bridges, and we won every single one of them. And no one else was really doing bridges at the time, so suddenly we were the people that did bridges, and it's kind of almost stuck. There are other architects, many of whom have worked in our office, who are also doing bridges now. But that suddenly got us onto the international stage, and we started looking at projects in America and Hong Kong and so on, to look at bridge projects. And we enjoy them because they're a bit like designing a piece of furniture. It's quite tough, but they're very contained, brief, and they're also very contextual, which is the other aspect of which I enjoy. And then moving slightly from railways and engineering type projects to sort of more museums and visitor attractions, this is a science adventure centre at Bristol. Which was a goods railway shed, and converted into this. It was a listed building. And then other visitor attractions like Magna and so on. And I'm showing you these, and it's and one that I was just showing you my projects, but on another level, it's the story of the practice. And I wanted to try and show to you that actually it's not that premeditated. It kind of like happens. You see the opportunity, you decide, will I take it or not? And you go for it, and if you win it, you're doing it. If you do it, you've got to do it well. And it's, as one gets bigger, then there are more opportunities and more opportunities. You can keep chasing. This won a Sterling Prize. Gateshead also won a Sterling Prize the following year. And then the same bunch of architects have done a lot of exhibition design, which is another area we just sort of quite like doing, because it's really kind of close and interesting work. With museums and master planning at Kew, and then individual buildings at Kew. Another lesson in a way, you know, this tiny little building on the bottom left, the Alpine House at Kew, is only 18 metres long and 9 metres high, led to this building, which is the Gardens by the Bay in Singapore, which Paul mentioned earlier, which is more like, you know, more like 200 metres long and 100 metres across and 35 metres high. That's that one. The other one is taller and smaller. And that was really about the building up, I suppose, building up a reputation and recognising that it's a very narrow field, botanical gardens, and that, you know, that you've got to exploit the work that you've done to get the next project and the next opportunity, which you're hoping, of course, will be even more interesting. And this is a very unusual project. They're cooled conservatories. Moving on again to the sort of buildings where large numbers of people congregate. The arena in Liverpool is a conference centre that also has shows and so on, next to a World Heritage Site. To different kind of architecture in a way, of university architecture, using materials, stone and so on, this is earth sciences. But we've always got an interest in the sort of the geometry, the idea. I think I heard it referred to earlier. That if one develops the idea early, you test that idea, but once you've established it, you go try and hang on to it and not let it become diluted. The Bodleian Library I'm sort of working on at the moment is on site, and this is a library for special collections in the Charles Gilbert Scott building in Oxford. There's about another year of construction to go to projects at Exeter. And now, what I want to show you is another thread of the work, which is the towers. We did it's the tallest back extension in the world, as far as I know. It's a 28-storey addition to the Empress Tower in West London, which you might recognise for land securities. And then suddenly, we knew about towers. And we managed to get a consent for a 40-storey tower at Brighton Marina, which yet to be built, but on a piece of land that isn't a piece of land, it's a piece of sea. But nevertheless, a remarkable consent to another one on Blackfriars Road, which was probably running concurrently with the Guangzhou one. These are these sorts of projects, this is right next door to one of Simon's actually, require a sort of, to get a planning consent for a tower in London, it requires sort of military-like organisation. There's so many characters involved, so many people to please, and really quite convoluted processes to go through. You have to be quite well organised to do that, and you need to be prepared to listen a lot to what other people are saying, and work out which battles are the ones to fight and which ones to run in order to fight, actually. And then this is the Guangzhou International Finance Centre, which I think is more said perhaps under-publicised, but I think the best thing to do is to go to Guangzhou and stay in the 7-star hotel, one of their lovely rooms, and just enjoy it. It is rather extraordinary. It's that one in the foreground you might recognise is Zaha's front house, which is nearby. Just up the road in next to the Euston Tower, we have an office building which is completing. And people think, oh, Wilkinson Elliot, they've done lots of office buildings. Well, actually, this is our first office building in the UK, new office building in the UK of any size. And I think it was one of the biggest lettings last year. A much smaller one down in Soho has also been completed. I think the sort of inherent flexibility of different approaches, different interests in engineering and geometry, etc., we used on the Olympics, on cable car, on Siemens, its crystal building in London recently finished, museum recently, and this swimming pool at Worthing literally just finished. And Mary Rose Museum here opens to the public on Friday. So I did mention before the importance of publicity, press, etc. And we watch it very carefully. We do try and get things published. I'll show you the one on the left. This was a headline in BD by Robert Booth. Nerve gas link hits China job. Where we were doing a job where we found the client was called Sinochem. It was just an office building, but apparently they had sort of slightly sinister chemicals that they were producing that we knew nothing about. So things can jump out of the woodwork. Another thing is we discovered that we didn't have FSC wood on the hoardings on a project, and that would be a big story. But on the right, you can get lots of good ones. We just won a 60-story tower in Sydney, in Barangaroo, which we're just starting to work on. I think I've covered most of the points that I want to, but I think anyone else will pick up on questions. There's a lot more, but I think it's a better deal with the discussion.
Jim, thank you very much. Jim and Joe to come back. Jim, just tell us about the physical nature of your office. How's it organised? How's it changed over the years?
So, well, we've moved from one premises to another. We started off in Horseshoe Yard, in a tiny little space in the back of a shop fronted onto Bond Street. And it was very clearly then, to Chris and myself, and and our assistants, and we kind of directed everything. We then moved to Bowling Green Lane, actually, underneath Zaha's office. We began bigger than Zaha, even though we were in a very small space. She eventually took over the entire building. We then moved. I was very pleased to move, because that office, you couldn't see the sky or the ground or any trees. And that was, I felt, was rather depressing. It was rather cool to look out the window and see life going. We moved to the centre of the world, as I've just found out, on Earl Street roundabout. And since I've moved back to Bowling Green Lane on the other side of the road to Zara. But I think that, and our office is a typical, I think, open plan office. We all sit in pretty much the identical spaces. It looks very democratic, but it is, actually. You know, let's not kill ourselves. But I think being open plan means you're accessible to everyone. People can come up to you, they can talk to you whenever they want, and you can see what's going on.
Jim, tell us a bit about TFA. What's the office like? All open plan?
Yeah, I mean, variously, when we've moved, it's always been one space. It's always been specifically one space that we've looked for and got. So,
big table in the middle, or is it kind of clusters?
No, it tends to be big tables in meeting rooms, partly because there's a kind of focus that goes on, and you can have more informal discussions around your desk, but actually to go away. It's about this thing before about some formality of actually introducing going somewhere rather than being the same place.
Jay, you've got the luxury of twice as much space as it could be said that you need, although on the other hand, it's obviously part of your working method.
Yeah. We have, I suppose, one of the ambitions was to have us, if you're sort of thinking about a kind of completely sort of flexible arrangement of hot desking, you probably wouldn't build any desks, just have tables and they kind of float around, but actually you need to have a structure in which to work, so desks are plugged into IT stations, they're all fed back to a server. So there's a sort of rigorous space, which is about 20 odd stations, and the rest of the space is free-flowing, so people can break out, they can go up and down, they can make models in the toilets if they want to. Is that generous? Yeah, they're very big toilets. We have no real sort of, you know, sort of dictatorship on how people use the space, other than we're providing it so people can use it. And it's such a low rent that for 20 odd people, which kind of overheads, it just about works.
So do you want to say a quick word about, you mentioned, referred to this briefly last week, about you've now got, as it were, the office of your dreams. But can you say what informed the ideas about how you are structuring the office within a new environment, and what the opportunity to design the office has meant in terms of relating it to the way the office works, or how it might change?
To me?
Yeah.
I mean, we moved to 20,000 square foot, 25,000 square foot, top of the building we've always been in. So if we liked the idea, it was consistent with our history. So it wasn't like this idea that you've grown, you've changed, and you suddenly make some new marker. So we liked the idea of continuity. I think there is an interesting thing about space that you end up saying, oh, it's great, we're all together on a couple of floors connected by a staircase, it doesn't get in by something being by July. But that actually, because you're together, you're together. And actually, I think when we were 9 different offices scattered around a warehouse, different floors, different segments, you have to work harder to be together. So part of our move to an office is kind of saying, it's convenient, it means you can wander over to people, you're not emailing them, or you're not spending 2 minutes going to find them and they're not there. So that's kind of part of the benefit. The other thing is the danger of saying, it's the office of our dreams, therefore we must be making great dreams together. And actually, it's the organisation of people and the culture of people and how they actually want to work together is in some ways more important than any physical manifestation. So you just try and make a physical thing that kind of reflects what you do. So we've got breakout that we didn't used to have. We've got the ability to see people that we didn't used to have, and we're just trying to exploit that. Ultimately, the physical office won't improve what we do, but it might enable us to be cleverer about working together.
think I'll echo those points, but what I didn't mention was that, you know, because of the international projects, we quite often have to set up a satellite office in the sort of host country. Because you need to be on hand, it can be a long way away, particularly if it's in the Far East. And our experience has been that's actually really difficult. We've always resisted trying to set up a permanent office elsewhere. It's always been rather temporary. And we have to work very, very hard at trying to stay properly in touch with this other office wherever it is. In fact, we now have what is a permanent office in Hong Kong, and it's a struggle, to be honest. It's a struggle to try and stay in sort of full communication, aided by technology, which makes it easier, but it's difficult.
But I was going to say, Paul, just briefly on that, our office is often not very full. Because often people are in Belgium or in wherever they are on projects at the other architect's office, actually. So kind of, we have this funny relationship with the space, which is often it's other architects' offices, which is kind of our office. So it's a changing dynamic in that sense, in terms of bringing an office.
I want to throw this out for two or three questions from the floor or comments, if anybody's got any. I mean, there's a really wide range of things. Arisen this evening as last week. Anybody got any questions for any of the... Yes, please, tell us who you are.
My name's Al, and I'm here at the Space Lab, the Space Analysis. I'm actually moving back to India to start my own FOMB Series 5 that I have for it. My question is quite simple, and some of you kind of alluded to it, just the idea of size. How important is the size that you have, the size of the organization? Is that it?
Does size matter? The age-old question. Well, we've got a whole range here. I mean, well, let's start with the smallest. I would have to say that an office of 20 people, 17 architects, is not that small. In the context of British architecture, it's quite sizable. Do you feel that you're a small office, Joe, actually, or you've got the compact? In Germany, you'd be quite a big office. Do almost anything.
On a personal level, I think it's as big as I probably could manage at the moment. I mean, as I sort of talk about this idea that it's sort of bottom up and we're all within a pond together, it's all about ideas frothing up. It does require a lot of sort of gardening to make that thing happen. So you have to be constantly engaged in the process. So things like this, for example, where you're out thinking about the practice for the day is quite important. This also pulls you away from decision making being involved. So I think 20 people is as sort of big as I probably can imagine as ever having been. Saying that, I do remember from the days of HMM that we don't plan to grow any further, and then you end up with almost 1,000 people. There's always been an opportunity that, as the needs come in and the projects present themselves, and there's a need to grow, then perhaps being organic and wanting to respond to that, then you do that and you find methods to deal with it. So I don't necessarily think the size matters. It's more an ambition, it's an attitude to the way that you deal with people and projects.
And actually, I think in all the presentations, I mean, Jim, actually, I mean, you've grown by doing jobs. It's not as though you've had a business plan that says, well, we're going to work in 12 different European countries, and that means we're going to have X number of people. It's just kind of the way it's developed.
I think there's in terms of our size, if you like, it's we've kind of taken the decision that actually growth gets absorbed by other offices with up their overheads and their risk. You know, so we've kind of got a model where we collaborate with other architects because it's broad. And that means we can really constrain our downside risk, because there is an architecture, it's cyclical, as Jim was saying. So you're really exposed to it when it stops happening. You know?
Jim, I thought your point about debt, I think for anybody starting a practice, this is very, very important, isn't it? Just kind of managing your financial risk, even in terms of employing staff, as opposed to using agency people or collaborating with other people.
No, I think it's tremendously important. I mean, the hoops that you have to go through to get debt now are very, very different from what they were 20, 25 years ago, probably even 5 years ago, actually. And to be in control of your own destiny is... it's a good thing. It's much better that way if you can do it, but of course that requires some startup funds or a very lucky break. And of course, the one of the reasons practices can fail, or any business can fail, is if it grows too rapidly. It needs to take on lots more people to do lots. lots more work, and then the payment either doesn't come or it lags so far behind. And there's been a few in the press in the last few years that people have this. And managing that is quite important. But one of the advantages of being big, of course, is that you've got lots of different jobs, and you can iron out some of this unevenness that you'd otherwise have. But I do think that, in a way, the decision to stay a certain size, which Jim has described, is a very conscious decision. And you can only do that if you're spreading out the work in some other way, or you're just very fortunate that jobs come at the right size at the right time. And we've just found that actually you look at every opportunity on its merits and you decide whether you're going to do it or not.
Yeah.
And that has tended to go with growth.
There was this theory that the RIBA put out reports and other people have done the same thing, saying that medium-sized practices are doomed to fail. You've either got to be, as it were, three men and a dog, and you've got to be a mega practice, and there's nothing in between. But actually, so I think the experience is, as we see around us, actually medium-sized practices either diminish or they grow. Some stay successfully medium-sized, but the idea that there's some sort of optimum, you've got to be one thing or the other from day one, denies evolution.
I think it's like you've got to be good and have an ambition that people want to gather around you to do that. And that ambition could be five people. In your case, five people grow to 120. In your case, maybe the ambition is interesting. So maybe a question for you, Jim, is the ambition centres around an individual called Tony and the desire for him to still be the author in conceptual terms, but maybe not actually in the broader authorship of people to make a project.
As always, yeah.
Yeah. I suppose in a sense, once you get to a certain size, there's an issue about people's careers and where their careers go if that author was to ever retire or change what they're going to do. So the thing about size becomes, once you get to a certain size, you have to think about the future even if you don't want to.
Yeah.
When you're six people, you can kind of say, we're living for today. When you're 100 people, and people have been there for 10, 12, 15 years, and they've been developing a career there, they don't want to know that next year, by the way, the founding partner said, well, thanks very much, we're retiring, winding the practice up. So size is not an issue in itself, but it does have implications for actually having to invent a future.
But it has an issue in relation to control, I think, design control. I showed you Stratford Station, which was sort of relatively early in the process, mid to late 90s. That was the last building where I knew every single detail in my head, every single one. I can't say that anymore, and I wouldn't be able to, it'd be possible.
Jeremy, we have I suppose the conundrum for us is if we stay at 20, unless trees are being felled, you can't have other trees sort of growing for the kind of, the healthy forest. So. And actually, we have a sort of dichotomy wanting to retain the good people. It's quite a difficult model to manage, which is staying at a kind of, compact, but kind of, clever and sort of dynamic output of 20 people. So it's always a case, a guy just left us at the moment, you're sort of thinking 6 to 7 years worth of invested interest, and he goes away. You sort of, the immediate reaction is, we've just lost our associate director. Actually, what it means is you re-mobilise within the practice, you've got
new opportunities.
So there are ways of doing it, but it's actually, I think it's quite a difficult thing to balance, and I think we're always wanting to promote people to give them a sense of ownership, authorship, and an attachment to the practice long term. But you can only have so many associate directors in 20 people, so it's, I think we've got quite a difficult model.
I'll take one more question if there is one. Yes, please.
Okay.
I'm
Casper Rogers, architect by Almec. For the most part, it sounds like they're responsive changes that you put into practice. Yet there's been one talk about, about this reverse engineering. Did that come about at a certain scale when you had enough time to pull back and look at practice, or was it always an ambition to implement something a little bit more? Described or an approach? Has there been other ones that you wanted to try?
I think it partly comes from the structure we have, which is that I kind of do have time to think about things like that because that's what I do. broadly speaking, than actually there's a kind of other thing that goes on in architecture, is everyone does everything. You know? And therefore nobody thinks about some things, but everyone thinks about some things a lot. And I've pretty much always thought about a particular aspect of practice, which is about how we do, how we do things on a day-to-day basis, as well as being obviously committed to the buildings that we make. It's about understanding how they're produced and how we all produce them. So, you know, we've always struggled, for instance, this question about size, because you don't all that into all soft competitions and EOIs, expression of interest in these things. So we've had to make certain decisions about how we resource ourselves. And one of those is we never don't pay anyone, for instance. And that's really difficult if you want to do competitions and stuff. And a lot of practices rely upon not paying people. So you make certain decisions, then you live by them one way or another. And that's sometimes challenging. But actually, in the long term, much better, I think.
For us, it's, we've got the thing that's hitting us is, you know, the idea of non-specialising, to be as broad as you can, to the broad church. We find that there's less and less fee for more and more output. And again, everything gets squashed. The kind of idea that you might depth batting, actually flatlining is a bad thing, because you have absolutely no flexibility for the one lack of payment, which might only be a £2,000 invoice, which could have some detrimental impact. And at the end of last year, I was sort of thinking, this is it, we're going to go under. And then January starts, and it's boom, everything explodes again. And suddenly you're basically encouraging, nurturing community plate spins. Every single person has to be the cleaner, the tea maker, the package for external cladding, to master planning, to, I don't know, it's a visualizer. So we have to be, everybody in our offices is a jack of all trades and a master of all of them as well. And it's really, really important. So we're looking for people who have that kind of really, really broad set of skills, self-managed, self-motivated, self-reliant, etc., etc.
Well, there's two points I want to make, really. One, I think it's quite interesting that Jim, we don't have the role that Jim has in his office. It doesn't exist in our office. There is a sort of practice management, a purely administrative and a bit of HR. So our equivalent of what you do is done by a board that meets every Monday morning, every Tuesday, it is actually, every Tuesday we meet to make the decisions, probably that you, some of which you make on your own. The other point I want to make is financial, which relates to, in a way, something that you said, is perhaps the question that you made earlier. I think is a really good guiding rule, if you can do it, is to always keep 3 months turnover in the bank. If you've got 3 months turnover, that's roughly how long it takes to, you know, get a project, do a bit of work, and get that first check-in. So if you've got 3 months turnover, you're pretty safe, actually. It's not that you can relax, but it makes a hell of a difference to
We've always found debt, we've always found it pretty easy to get debt. Not from the bank, but from the people who are supposed to pay us. So we reckon that sometimes we carry £3 or £4 million worth of work that's not yet paid for. Not because we're badly paid, but because it racks up and by the time we do it, but the invoice and all those kind of things. My only thing would be is we are all in different ways responsive. We don't control the market for the work. We respond to situations, and even 2008, which was very horrible for lots of people in different ways, was something, as an architect, I think most of us have to be optimists. You kind of say, well, how do we positively turn this crushing collapse of a lot of our projects into something that we use to engage ourselves and make ourselves a bit clever in a way? And the danger is, if you've got the idealised cash flow, the idealised flow of projects, you'll probably get a bit lazy and fat, and Jim might say, well, I wish we had more work in the UK, and I might say, well, I wish we had more work abroad, and Jim might say, I wish we had more work in January.
Yep.
The point is, there isn't the idealised work. It's always like, it's never quite what you want to be. You're responding to the situation, and if you're making a practice that isn't a slave to the situation, but it's kind of being forced to be clever. As architects, we like constraints.
Well, that's what I think. That's why the point about you do have this line which is bulging everywhere, so you have to make use of those.
Yeah.
You can't say, oh no, it's not working. You have to say, it needs to really balance. Yeah. How can we made them useful.
You can use that downtime, if you've got a bit of money in the bank, as Jim was saying, Jim McKinney can use it to go off and think a bit about how they're operating internationally. And what it is. So it's all about using the situation to respond, but obviously not getting taken out by the bank, because you actually run a good business that was short of money that month. That's the ultimate
challenge. But that is more difficult now than it was
before.
Yeah. Yeah.
By the way, I didn't say
we
had 3 months.
That's certainly a cheery note. Close. I must say, I did love those the non-straight lines, because I suppose the only thing missing from a kind of what we're told about how the left-hand side of the brain works, in fact, how designers, creative designers work, as opposed to, let's say, project managers or cost controllers, is that there are things that go looping round before rejoining that line, which eventually comes to some sort of conclusion and leads to a project. Well, I think a very interesting evening, slightly different in tone to last week. And in thinking, I think the answer I'm drawing from the two evenings as to this question which came first, the practice or the architecture, is I think what really we've heard is that actually the way you lay out your office is not going to inform the architecture you do, nor is it going to help you to win clients or expand or contract or carry on all those other things. But on the other hand, what we've heard is that the nature of practice in the round, including its physical formation, but in particular its structures, are themselves an aspect of a design process or an attitude to design and to architecture. And of course, in terms of the structures of ownership and succession, informed also by political and economic attitudes and attitudes to life itself, over and above the simple map of a business. And it's hard, especially for most of the young people in this room. You know, there are practices that, unless you're particularly interested in architectural history, you'd scarcely have heard of now. I was walking past that rather marvellous University of Westminster building, or was it Central Politics? I'm not sure, on Howard Street, by Lyons Israel Ellis. You know, a marvellous post-war practice that produced James Stirling work there, James Gowan work there, when Stirling won the competition to go off and do the housing scheme that set him up as an architect. The partners met and said, well, we better send Jim Gowan with it to make sure it gets built properly. I mean, there was this kind of incredible generosity of attitude. Richard McCormack worked there, and a lovely, a tale of yesteryear relating to this thing about the partner looking over the assistant architect's shoulder to see what they've got on their drawing board. Well, in the days when Richard McCormack was an assistant, he worked at Lyons Israel Ellis, and he'd been set to do drainage details for the first 6 months he worked there. Then on a Saturday morning, yes, practices used to work formally on Saturday mornings, up until relatively recently, actually, and Richard McCormack was doing tile layouts. And Israel, one of the partners of Lyons Israel, was walking round, looking at what every assistant was doing, looked over and said to Richard McCormack, improving yourself, I see. Tile layouts being distinctly one up from drainage details. These are kind of lost worlds of practice. And yet the things that survive from that marvellous practice right through to the sorts of work that we've heard about this evening, I think, can be properly summed up as, firstly, an aspiration to do good architecture, whatever the circumstances and whatever the size of the office was and whatever stage you are at in your career. But then, secondly, there's a kind of going beyond the aspiration to be good. There becomes an intention to do certain sorts of work, and the intention does eventually involve decisions about, should we go for that? Should we take that on? Should we do some landscape? Should we do a master plan? Should we combine ourselves to doing very small projects and actually stay as a niche practice working very happily in our own architectural tradition rather than go for a bigger and broader picture. And plenty of practices have done that very successfully for their whole careers. And then later on, if you make it bigger, if your aspiration is bigger and your intention is to, we'll take on all comers and we'll become as big and as good as we possibly can be, that then in itself raises a whole series of questions about how you structure your organisation where you can keep the aspiration as well as the intention to produce something which is decent and hopefully remain a good employer as well as a good architect. We see examples of famous practices and big names imploding every day around our ears with the most, you know, cynical and apparently incompetent and disastrous management structures. Now, happily, that's new because it doesn't actually happen very often. And I think what we've heard this evening and last week is very frank accounts from a series of very different practitioners of the issues that they've encountered and how they try to deal with them. But I think especially in the School of Architecture, one would say there is no point in merely being an efficient business, certainly not if you're in the architecture game, unless there is a purpose, which is to do something good with the environment which inevitably architects will create for better or for worse for all the people who live, work and play in them. Can I thank the AA for, and St. Jacob actually, for as part of this night school initiative. I'd like to thank Simon Wolford and AHMM and Morag Tate in particular for doing a lot of kind of organisational work to make sure that this all happened. And in particular this evening, thank Jim McKinney, Joe Morris and Jim Eyre and Simon, of course, for their contributions. Thank you very much.